As I mentioned, that if you measure only metabolomics, then you get some information. So you have to integrate whatever knowledge already we have. So in talk, I will tell something about GWAS or genome-wide association studies, then EWAS, epigenome-wide association studies, then MWAS, metabolome-wide association studies, and then examples in metabolomics, especially in cancer or other diseases, how they have been used. So since genome came first, and in genome, based on that, our knowledge has come. So previously, only about one gene or locus we knew, and then as time passes by, for different chromosomes, for different diseases, we knew locus, and we collected information about that. And gradually, we knew association of some genes, where they are located, and how to approach for either control, treatment, or risk assessment. So that way, we completed about genome. Now, when we gain more knowledge, then we knew that our genome is not everything, it is not our fate. Then epigenome came, where without change of nucleotides, change in expression of gene can happen in a disease. And best example came from those monozygotic twins, in which discordance was followed, was observed later on, whether these are cardiovascular diseases or others. And these twins were alike, which gave us impression that environment is the most important thing which we understand, we should understand and keep into consideration. And that is not only for cardiovascular disease, but for other diseases also there. And in these monozygotic twins also, it has been followed that in certain diseases, genetic factor is more important. In other diseases, epigenetic factor is more important. In certain cases, suppose you are studying genome, you sequence one time, that's good enough from any cell you can take. Epigenome or metabolome, for different cell or tissue, you have to do more time. So these are more labor-consuming, but they also give useful information. At the same time, certain things affect whether it is genetic, metabolomic, or epigenetic. Other thing also you have to keep in mind, that whenever something happens in the environment or other things, certain changes are dynamic, something are permanent. So mutations or SNPs or copy number changes or variation, they come after you are exposed for longer time. But for short time, certain factors like transcription factors, cell cycle regulatory molecules, they are affected. And in between comes methylation, histone modification, etc. And throughout the life, you see that even before birth, environment is affecting very much what is going to happen. So all these things affect your fate or what disease you will develop, whether it is genetic, epigenetic, or metabolomic, that we have to do. At least in epigenetics at different stages, in our roadmap epigenetics program, these were analyzed for methylation profiling, at least 12 sites in histone modifications, as well as microRNA profiling and DNase1 mapping. That has been done. Initially, maternal effect is more, but later on, all its environment. And samples, different samples at different stages you can take. For genomic and epigenomic, it has been done, but systematically in metabolomics, that has not been done. So it will be done or someone will do, but it will be very useful. So exposome or whatever is in the environment or people are exposed throughout their life or for a short time, that is the key you have to keep in mind throughout your life. I told about roadmap program and common fund metabolomics. And in that metabolomics, our centers, which are the resource centers. So if you have some project in which you don't have expertise, you want it to be completed, contact me or PIs of these centers, and we can arrange based on that evaluation, what you want to do, how you will use. So that's how we are promoting. These are our centers. And San Diego is our data coordination center. And in regional comprehensive centers, what are the key things? First of all, experimental design, in that they will help sample processing for different technology and data analysis. Same way for advanced metabolomic technologies, multi-omic integration, imaging, high and unique capabilities, and technologies for the development and early adaptation. And for outreach, the way we are doing, we organize workshop or help people collaborate, or we give funds also. These are called administrative supplement. So anytime you find some investigator, you have a project, then we can fund that investigator and then he can or she can give you subcontract. If you have not done metabolomics. If you have done, then directly you can collaborate. So that's how also we are promoting that. How to access course, there is a procedure. So on the website you can see, some are fee for service, some centers are just through NIH, it can be done. So in the free time, whenever if you are interested, then I would be interested to explain about that. For various amount and time you can do. This has been emphasized so much in the conference that why metabolomics? This is the process which is so close to phenotype or the association with disease, directly you can infer something. That's why we are doing another parts I covered in my morning talk. So the way we do genome-wide association studies, usually these studies are conducted in such a way that you have cohort of people who are enrolled. They have not developed any disease, but we have data about their exposure data, their lifestyle, what do they eat, what is their family history. Then we follow and we collect samples for different time. So in that, if profiling is also done for metabolomics, and already we are doing for genomics or SNP variation or epigenomic, then we see that how we can integrate and get this kind of information. And then based on some models, then we predict which population or which group of people they are likely to develop disease. And then it can be also modified for personalized basis. And this I emphasize in the morning, that the early you detect a disease or some marker you can get, that is the better. And in that also, resources of cohorts are very important, because once you get some indication that you are getting good marker, you can go back. About metabolomic workflow, most of the people know every individual lab has different kinds, but sample preparation is the key, and then selection of the technique as well as research design and methods. This was the example I showed, that different populations based on metabolites or metabolomic association studies, they were conducted, and these are the steps for flow chart in which it was done, and that was done in Imperial College. And in this example, where branch chain amino acid, they predicted diabetes risk. And you can see the number of participants. So they are so much. And based on that and metabolomic analysis, it could be done. At the same time, another study was done for cardiovascular diseases. So in that also, metabolomic markers were used. Another example I want to give for Intermap study. In that also, hundreds and thousands of people were enrolled, and then metabolomic profiling was done. And all these analysis, which were for that analysis, that were urine metabolite analysis based, and 4,000 participants were there from 17 populations. Another reason in our epidemiology why we collect samples from different populations, because in US, people come from all countries. Initially, their lifestyle or habits or nutrition, all those things were different, and here they change. We have done some migration studies. People living in Japan, they used to have gastric cancer more. Once they adapted American life, then gastric cancer was down and colon cancer started. So those things happen because of life changes and other things. And in this example, that is for cardiovascular disease. And then in cancer, ovarian cancer, where we don't have marker, for early detection, incidence and prevalence, those are such that very short time, 2 to 5 years is the survival time. So in that also, discrimination power of metabolite, that was realized. And the reason I am giving this information is that it is not in one or two patients, but large number of people that was done, and all is published. And in this case, the technology applied or research design using plasma for metabolomic analysis for ovarian cancer sample, that is shown, and how they could distinguish one kind of metabolite with others, that has been shown. Okay, now lung cancer, which is also a key cancer, in that also, in smokers and non-smokers, that study was done, and in that, in a case control study, participants were 18,000. And those were designed properly like smokers versus non-smoker, age matched or sex matched, those kinds of very well designed. And there also certain metabolomic profiling or markers were found which were promising. And these markers, for the foremost, we want to use for screening. In those cohort of people where disease has not developed, if there is some sign, then we get alerted. At the same time, we get information. And all these databases at NIH, at least we are putting in NCBI or EMBL from Europe or in data coordination centers for different common funds so that we can extract that information and can integrate. This was for endometrial cancer. Here also 179 cases, 336 controls. Another example from prostate cancer. So far PSA is the only one which is in clinic, but below 4 nanogram per ml, doctor does not know whether to treat or not to treat. In that also it can help. At the same time, like glutathione methylation, that is also coming up a good marker. So we want that people should do multiplexing. Here also more than 1,000 subjects were enrolled in this study. Pancreatic cancer, in that as well, serum analysis could indicate pancreatic cancer. What are the issues in this metabolomics which we have identified? And NIH want that investigators like you should help us. First of all, important challenges, downstream metabolomic profiling at the time of study design. Then qualifying samples, what are those? Then conducting first pilot studies, then identifying appropriate sample handling. High throughput, that is the main thing. Anything cannot come in clinic if you have not done epidemiological studies. So if you develop an assay, it should not be for cell line or animals, but for human, and high throughput also will be necessary. Then targeted or untargeted, any approach you apply as long as clinical implication is there. And then combining data set, whatever is your at institute, with the general data in coordination center. Collect information about the environmental exposure or whatever you can collect, and then use that for identifying populations at high risk. Integration is the key in these omics studies, and we have at NIH another program. It's called ITCR, Informatics Technology in Cancer Research. So in that, another data set is being developed where only those models, like Galaxy most of the time people use. So epigenomic, metabolomic, and other omics, that data, they are developing such models where you can integrate. And those tools are available for general public. And then analytic and clinical validation of biomarkers, which are giving you some promise. So key to my presentation or the message I want to give, that to follow up the field metabolomics, go to metabolomics site, and most of the information we update almost on daily basis, or for any kind of developing collaboration or writing a project or other things, my email is in that booklet. You can send to me and I will try to answer those or do. And here I have shown what are the centers which have been funded in first round. But these projects are such, once we start based on what is the need, how much questions we answer, either we expand or shrink, those decisions we make, but those are there. So I will be happy to take any question. Thanks. Thank